Hey, little girl, is your daddy home? Did he go and leave you all alone? I got a bad desire.
And we're live.
Hello and welcome back to another Nick Cage Can Cook My Dinner Anytime He Wants To episode of the First Time Watchers podcast.
This is a deconstructed episode because we like to watch.
My name is Tim Costa.
I'm Hermano Da Silva.
And I am a very special foam known as Walter Vinci.
If you'd like to send feedback, you can always email us at firsttimewatchers@gmail.com. Speaking of feedback, so I guess if you want to keep it movie related, how was your summer, guys, since we are now returned from our summer break? You had a couple of months off. Movie related, Hermano, how was your summer? Exciting?
As far as movies go?
Sure.
Well, I've fully embraced my new movie watching reality. I haven't been to a theater still. The last movie I saw in theaters was Onward. Wow. Whenever that came out 2 years ago or whatever.
Sure.
Everything I've been watching, like I keep joking with Tim and Wally that I love what I'm seeing a lot of the streaming services do, like HBO Max specifically and Paramount Plus as well. For some kids' films that I was able to watch, like, you know, just at home, and it's so convenient. I understand people's love for the theater, but I think I'd be okay if like theaters became more of a boutique thing, like sort of like Alamo Drafthouse, and you know, only for like, you know, bigger blockbustery things like IMAX. I've seen a few films in IMAX, and I certainly can vouch for that experience. But for everything else, I'm totally fine watching stuff at home. Like I have no bones to pick with any sort of, you know, like visual quality or the sound. Like I have a sound bar, I have a subwoofer, I have a big screen TV. Like if that movie still can't reach me outside of a theater, then there's something wrong with the movie, not me.
What about you, Wally?
I've been looking for a house. That's been the top priority. And mainly getting the 48-hour film project up and running again this year, coming back from COVID shutdown last year. We're bringing it back. We've got 18 teams this year, which is pretty good for a bounce back from a season where I think we had not even double digits. And so getting that all set up to run and get that all done virtually has been pretty much the focus of my summer.
Hey, well,
and playing Twilight Magic and launching a Twitch stream.
Oh, exciting. A Twitch stream. Do you want to pimp out your Twitch channel?
That will be that's twitch.tv / The Amazing Wally.
The Amazing Wally. Humble.
You come watch Lose at Magic.
In regards to the 48-hour film project, where can people go to watch previous submissions?
So they can go to the 48-hour film project website for their city and see what they have there. You can also buy the tickets right now on Eventive for the 48-hour film project Providence. If you go to eventive.com/Providence, I believe is the link. I'll correct that later. You should be able to pick up passes to be able to watch the live stream and the live stream with the Q&A with the directors Thursday night and Friday night, starting at 7 p.m. Eastern Standard Time.
Interesting. During my summer, I went to New York City, and movie-related, I went to the Museum of the Moving Image in Astoria, Queens, which is right at Kaufman Studios, a pretty well-known movie production studio. And I saw some stuff from 2001 A Space Odyssey. I saw stuff from Jim Henson and the Henson production crew, and a lot of history there, a lot of cool stuff that I learned about, and some really cool displays. Yeah, if you guys if anybody is ever in New York City, I highly recommend taking a drive or a subway over to Queens so you can see anything that they have a display at the Museum of the Moving Image. Moving on. In this episode, we'll begin season 2 of 2021 with the surprise Nick Cage indie hit, Pig. But before we get into that, it is time for Yay or Nay. Yay! This is the part of the show where we discuss what we have seen recently on our own. I will go first, I guess, catching up on some big summer releases. I did watch Black Widow, finally released in theaters. I think it serves as a pretty good companion to the end of Endgame, Avengers Endgame. And it's you know, serves the purpose of introducing new characters that will probably be featured in later MCU installments. But that's, you know, at this point, if you're not all in, well, I don't know what you're even doing here. You know, Johansson is serviceable. She doesn't do anything particularly new with the character, but I do like how she sidelines herself at times and allows Florence Pugh as a newcomer to, you know, to take center stage. It's funny. A lot of the action, you know, at times it does feel like tangible and real, but there's other times where it's pretty weightless. You probably see the trailer, and which features this big action set piece, which is at the end of the movie, and the final action set piece is like, it's impossibly weightless. It feels, I'm like, it's like going through the motions essentially, which, you know, a lot of these movies tend to do. For better or worse. And this one is like, kind of like, all right, I guess, whatever. I just wanted to get to the end of it. And, you know, but I like the pacing of the story. I had a good ebb and flow. And it's a good movie. It's a good movie. Decent send off for Scarlett Johansson there. Next up, I did see No Sudden Move, the Steven Soderbergh film that was released on, I think it was Netflix. No, HBO? I don't know. Where was it? Oh, damn. Anyways, it was streaming somewhere. You guys can look
at HBO.
Thank you. It is a, you know, Steven Soderbergh, the master of always experimenting. And this one is a densely packed homage to 1940s noirs and 70s crime thrillers. And once again, proves that Steven Soderbergh can literally do anything. Hermano, you always look for directors, as you've said in the past, look for directors who can, you know, handle multiple projects, do multiple genres, and I think he's a perfect example. This movie reminded me like of a mix between Jackie Brown, Goodfellas, and Le Cirque Le Rouge. The cast, the wild cast is, you know, it's really great. You got Don Cheadle and Benicio del Toro at the front and center, but David Harbour plays a supporting character. He really stuck out to me, you know, mixing some, you know, the right amount of everything you need in that type of role. So once again, yay for No Sudden Move. It's a good movie. And then I watched Fast 9. I watched Fast 9, guys, in the theater after it was delayed a little over a year. And, oh, my God, guys.
Did you watch it with your family?
No, I watched it by myself because I'm my own family. Yeah, Fast 5 and Fast 6 are the superior films in this franchise. And I think in Fast 9, they finally, you know, find that right balance of mixing, like, full shark jump, which is most evident in Fast 8. And the over earnestness of the meaning of family, you know, and they blend it all to make it, you know, like a laugh inducing and heart wrenching moments all earned in every scene. This movie is fantastic. It does go full MCU by creating flashbacks that take about like a quarter of the runtime to justify every decision made with the characters and the scripts throughout the entire series. And after this movie, I am more convinced than ever that Paul Walker's Brian is definitely going to return for the majority of the runtime of at least one of the final two films in the series. And I will stand up and applaud. I will love it. Justin Lin comes back and directs this, and it really gets the series back on track. And I think he really does a good job of bringing these action set pieces, you know, make them thrilling again and really add, I don't know, some more, I don't know, they felt a little bit too, it's impossible to say too silly in a series like this, but for some reason it all works, you know, as crazy as they do get. And yes, they do go to outer space, and it's glorious because Lucas Black is the rocket scientist that helps them make it happen. It's awesome. It's amazing. It's one of the best in the series. It's highly entertaining. Hermano, I can't wait until you have a chance to see this. You're gonna dig it. You're gonna love it. And finally, Hermano, you may be able to weigh in on this one. Paw Patrol the movie. I don't know how much you paid attention to it while your kids were watching.
I was about 25% invested.
Look, I think this is perfectly serviceable entertaining for this type of film, especially considering how my daughter, who is a lifelong fan of the show, really wanted me to watch this because this was her second time watching it. She had already seen it before me, and it was nice hearing her urging me to pay attention to what was coming up because that's how much she enjoyed it. Let me ask you something, Hermano. How am I supposed to interpret the Loan Protection and Safety Organization, which is a privately funded firm run by a megalomaniacal 10-year-old white boy, worked by puppies who've been indoctrinated by said megalomaniac, and the relationship with the town and city they oversee? You know, they're idolized by every citizen and seen as saviors for every obstacle, major and minor. How am I supposed to view this?
I don't know. I don't have the answers for you, Tim. I wish I had them. I wish I had some answers for myself. I thought I had dodged this series because my oldest son never got into it, but my youngest son unfortunately did. And I had, you know, the unfortunately I had to watch some Paw Patrol stuff with him, the series, of course. And knowing this was coming out, you know, I wouldn't deprive him of the movie, so. You know, we did have a family movie night, and I think maybe it is the carryover from the series where I wasn't that excited overall to see it, which led to me not fully paying attention and sneaking to my phone every once in a while. And it did look like a pretty serious upgrade as far as the quality.
Yes.
You know, the animation looked nice. Absolutely. You know, and all that. The story was more polished. They had, I think, better comedic stuff overall. Which is saying not saying a lot for Paw Patrol.
That's true.
The kids liked it, you know, like that's the only way I can really judge this one specifically, because it's not really for me. It's specifically for kids. Like, you know, like it's not really for an adult. Adult is just a passenger on this ride. So, yeah, it was fine. You know, like I think the story had heart. You know, I liked the little dog there who needs to find his courage again or something.
Right.
That was a nice touch because the series never really has enough time to, you know, dig into things like that because, you know, again, it's like a, 17-minute episode or whatever. So
something like that.
Yeah. They did, I think, the best they could with elongating this tired premise.
It's interesting, though. This is a G-rated film, and it's something we don't see that much nowadays is a G-rated kids film. And I think, you know, as snarky as I've been, you know, I think there is a message of overcoming your fears, being kind, and it has completely harmless jokes in it. And it's a nice change of pace considering all the PG stuff that comes out that I don't know, you can definitely tell the difference in tone between a Disney Pixar film and this, right? It's.
Oh, yeah. There's really no, like, potential scarring scenes in this film. Like a Disney film will almost always do that. Like someone will die. There'll be something really traumatic, like parents dying, or, you know, like Big Hero 6 scarred my oldest son because of what happens in that film, like early on. And so, I mean, this movie is not really going for that. It is more of like I'd say the age range for this movie is like, you know, 3 to 6 maybe.
Sure.
Yep. You know, like that's the perfect age to watch something like this.
Yep, I agree. All right, what else have you watched, Romano?
All right, I'll just talk about the two most recent things I watched. There's a new documentary series on Netflix called Untold. You guys heard of this?
Yes.
So the first one I watched, it's split up, I think it's going to be all sports related from what I can tell. The first two that are out, I've only seen one of them. The one I didn't see is about I think the first female boxer,
okay,
like televised and all that. It's her, like her story and her, I guess, tumultuous relationship with her husband. The one I did see was the one that really captured my eye was Malice at the Palace. Tim, I'm sure you'll remember this.
I do remember this event. I haven't seen this the show yet.
So for people that don't know, Malice at the Palace, in 2004, after a game between the Indiana Pacers and the Detroit Pistons at Detroit, there was a little pushing and shoving between the players, and it transitioned into a fan throwing something at Ron Artest and all hell breaking loose. Ron Artest jumps into the stands, starts trying to fight fans. Some other players get involved, go in there after him. They get into it with fans. Fans start running on the court trying to fight players. It was like absolute pandemonium. Like, I remember seeing, I think I was actually watching this game as it happened. I don't remember. It might have not have been. I think they covered it so much at the time. Like, I feel like I probably watched the game, even though maybe I didn't. Like, because ESPN, it was all anyone could talk about, like, for like a week, the whole week after this happened, because it was unheard of. Like, I think, I don't know if you'll agree with me, Tim, but like, basketball is maybe the only sport where I could see something like this really happening on any given night because of the how close players and fans are to one another.
Yeah, it's true.
A lot of other sports, I mean, hockey maybe, but there's the glass, you know, you'd have to go over. But baseball, you know, you might see a knucklehead run on the field every now and then, but soccer is the same thing. But basketball is just set up for this. The fans are so, you're within a foot of like million-dollar athletes, like if you're sitting on the sidelines. So, I mean, to get really into it, like, it mostly features the Indiana players. They get Reggie Miller, Ron Artest, Steven Jackson, Jermaine O'Neal. They get Ben Wallace, who was the other player on the Detroit Pistons that was also suspended because of this. You know, they get a couple of news broadcasters, some of the referees weigh in on, you know, this event. And they even get the fan that ran, one of the fans that ran onto the court and tried to fight Jermaine O'Neal. It's pretty crazy because at the time, the way it was being covered is that it was mostly because of the players. The players instigated it. They ran into the stands. But, you know, listening to them tell their stories about how they were portrayed and how it affected them and how this affected their entire season, it was like Reggie Miller's final season. And they had a really good Indiana team. They were gunning for the championship. They were like one of the favorites at the time.
Yeah.
And Detroit, you know, had just won it the year prior. And, you know, they were in the same conference as Detroit, so they, you know, they have to face each other, so it's a little bit of rivalry there. And this whole thing just like completely unraveled this team, and it's really unfortunate. They actually, I couldn't believe this, but they actually were able to nail down exactly the first fan to throw something. The guy that hit Ron Artest, he should be playing basketball because he was probably like 50 feet away. And he chucked a bottle like a freaking, like a rainbow shot, like straight up in the air. And he hit Ron Artest laying down on the scorer's table right in the chest.
Wow.
I'm like, holy crap, what an amazing freaking shot. But, of course, I really felt for Reggie Miller because listening to him tell the story, and this is his 18th season playing. It was, wow. He didn't know it was going to be his final season, but he ended up just calling it quits right there and then. And just realizing that guy was one of those guys that this was a real chance for him to finally win a ring, and it was completely undone by, you know, stupid fans, you know, just throwing something onto the court like that. So it's really unfortunate, but it's a really well done documentary. It's not very long. It's like 1 hour and 8 minutes. I would highly recommend it to Tim. I think you should check it out. Mm-hmm. And then I watched this superhero thing. I watched, thanks HBO Max for, providing me entertainment. I watched Suicide Squad.
Hey, so did I.
The Suicide Squad, I should say. Have to put that "the" in there.
It's true.
You watched this too, Tim?
I did.
Okay, so
I've heard this is the best Suicide Squad.
It was the what?
I heard this is the best Suicide Squad.
Well, I don't wanna put down David Ayer.
Oh my gosh.
Knowing that what was released is not, I guess, his preferred cut.
Okay.
I guess I'll never know which one I would have liked more, but I do probably like it better than what was released by the studio. I think it's a little bit more in line with what I like about the Guardians of the Galaxy, which is obviously a no-brainer considering it's the same director, but he takes goofy characters and keeps them goofy, basically. Like, I think there was no room for like all the seriousness really that was in the David Ayer one, it felt off. You know, it was like trying to ride this line and try to have it both ways with like the absurd and the kind of heartfelt serious stuff. And I think he didn't handle it that well in that film, or that cut wasn't that great at it. This one, they kind of do it as well, but it's more goofy than it is like serious overall. Like there's a couple of moments like on a bus with, you know, Idris Elba and Ratcatcher 2. Ratcatcher 2 is pretty much the emotional core of the film.
Right.
Everybody else is pretty much goofy. King Shark is like a scene stealer. I kind of liked him overall. I thought he was fun for what the movie is. And you know, it's in a way it's not as serious as the David Ayer one, but it feels much darker. But
oh well, yeah, it is tonally dark because of the, you know, a lot of people have compared it to Super, like the tone of James Gunn's Super, and yep. I can see that. I definitely agree with it because there's a scene in here in which they take down a whole camp of people, and the resulting joke of it is like a kick in the gut. Like what?
Yeah, it's in another movie, in the David Ayer cut, that would have been played like not for laughs, but right. In this movie it's played for laughs, and it's like that's not really funny, but it's like an awkward funny.
Yeah,
you know what I mean? Like he captures that awkward funny really well. Like, and there's another joke too, which I didn't laugh because it's not funny, but where, you know, a character, that character, the Weasel or whatever, a Weasel.
Yep.
Like as Rick Flagg is discussing him, he's like, says like, oh, he's killed like 27 kids. And it's kind of played for laughs, but it's not funny, but it's like another awkward moment in the film where it's like, oh, that would be like an awkward laugh moment, you know, where it's like, it's an uncomfortable moment, but it's like played for laughs. I don't know. There's a lot of moments like that in the film where it's like a dark scenario, but like it's sort of put on screen for laughs. But somehow it sort of works. I mean, it's totally in line with everything you've seen throughout the rest of the film. I really liked the Ratcatcher character too. Like, again, like I'm glad she's there as like a little bit of an emotional core to the film. Without her, I don't think I would have liked the film as much if it was just about the, you know, the gore and the, you know, the uncomfortable moments.
I completely agree with you. I'm not sure I'm rating it nearly as high as a lot of other people are, who are probably in turn rating it higher based on their previous disillusionment with the DCEU. And for me, it's, you know, a lot of this rests on Margot Robbie and my affinity for her version of Harley Quinn. And I think that she is the best thing to happen to the DCEU. I mean, the scene of the film, I think, belongs to her, and it's funny how it's reminiscent of the police station raid in Birds of Prey. I don't know if you saw that, Hermano, Birds of Prey.
Yeah, I did.
Yeah, yeah, and it's very reminiscent of that scene, and I just want to see her play this role every 2 years. I think she's that good and that amazing to watch, and has that much of a command of the character. In the movie, I also wanted more of the weird doctor played by Peter Capaldi. And I like Idris Elba. I like how he headlines a film like this, and I don't think the emotional arc that they're trying to go for fully lands, you know, or is really that fleshed out, because I don't think there's enough time for it to be.
Oh, with him and his daughter,
right.
Yeah, I thought that was just kind of glossed over. I thought, you know, I'm glad that more of the emotional stuff went to the rat catcher, mostly in flashback too, but still worked overall.
Yeah, I agree. That's the A for Suicide Squad. Is that it for you, Hermano?
That's it.
All right, Wally, what do you got? Let's wrap this up.
All right, so let's talk about a couple of things that I got to see over the summer, starting with the new Kevin Smith joint, Masters of the Universe Revelation. The War for Eternia begins again. It'll be the final battle between He-Man and Skeletor. It's got some pretty decent voice talents. You've got Sarah Michelle Gellar as Teela, Mark Hamill as Skeletor, Diedrich Bader as Trapjaw, Lena Headey as Evil Lyn, Justin Long is Roboto. Henry Rollins is Triclops. So this, it's kind of an interesting new take on already familiar characters. They kind of make, without having like inside jokes, they do make cheeky references. Like they kind of, there's a gag early on where they're talking about how incompetent a villain the Skeletor actually is. There's a joke in there too about like He-Man's one-liners, that he's got like a teenager sense of humor. The voice acting, I couldn't put my finger on it, but it just didn't quite strike me. Like I feel like the voice of Scareglow, who shows up later, should have been the voice of Skeletor instead, because I think there's a much more presence there. The story, people were bitching about online. They were really butthurt about this. But I had no problem with how the story plays out. Like, I thought it's a pretty awesome quest. And it ends on a cliffhanger. So hopefully when this does well enough that they'll get the second season, and we'll see where this goes from here post-cliffhanger and how they get this all resolved. But I will say that Masters of the Universe Revelation is a yay. And now the exact opposite of this. It's Transformers War for Cybertron Kingdom. So this is the third installment in the War for Cybertron trilogy. The first one, which is Siege, was fucking awesome. Earthrise was pretty good, and this is diminishing returns. So what happens is you have the crash of the Ark and a time rift that's never really explained how it all works. But you have the G1 Transformers living in the same planet and universe as Beast Wars. So you have Optimus Prime existing with Optimus Primal. The two Megatrons exist. And it's explained that the Beast Wars are the future of Autobots and Decepticons. So that's something. And it all revolves around like this really flimsy cameo that happens over the course of these past two seasons. It's not that great. I don't like the voice acting in this at all. I think Optimus Prime is clearly trying to emulate Adam West with like long pauses in between each word. Everyone else does a pretty decent job. The voice of Beast Wars Megatron, terrible. The voice of Optimus Primal, awful. This is a nay. Like I got through it to see where it was going. It's six episodes, and it feels like it could have been a better written story had they maybe stretched it out a little bit more or given it more depth, but no. Another interesting thing that I got to see over the summer was The Green Knight.
Yeah.
A fantasy retelling of the medieval story of Sir Gawain and the Green Knight, which I've read. And this movie follows that pretty well. And getting out of this, I was telling Kate, I was like, you know, I bet you David Lowry loves books. Because the way this movie ends, he's basically telling you should really read the rest of the story to see what happens next. Because it is not the complete story of the Green Knight. It gets to a certain point. It does something really cool at the end. And I'd say visually, this movie is awesome. I think this is one of those movies that I wasn't hot on when I left the theater, but given, you know, time and distance and all that, I've become much more warm to it. It may actually make my top five at this point. I think I told you over breakfast, will it make my top five? Probably not. I'm revising that to it might, depending on what else I end up seeing. But I would say this is a yay, man. If you like Ghost Door and you like these, you know, movies with a richness to them, I wouldn't say there's a lot of depth here because it's a really basic story, but the world all of this takes place in feels really rich and lived in, and it's interesting and it's strange at times. I would say The Green Knight is a yay all the way.
I agree with you. It's one film that while I liked it while I watched it and even afterwards, I it's something that has been rattling in my mind for a while. Also, Hermano, whenever you get a chance to see this, this is probably a film that you will enjoy quite a bit as well. and, you know, I was worried going into it because I heard, you know, people kind of complaining, I guess, about the pace of this movie, but it wasn't as deliberate as I was led to believe. There's always something interesting happening, and like you said, it's a great film to look at. I do appreciate the upending of expectations in terms of a knight on a quest for glory, you know, because Dev Patel plays what should be a role that's filled with courage and bravery, and instead he plays it as someone who is filled with constant self-doubt and worry. There's an unsureness to him that kind of took me off guard and made me curious as to the point of this journey and if he would ever overcome his mental obstacles. It was something that just kind of kept me on my toes, and I was always curious where it was going to go. I had no idea where this was going to go, and those are the best types of movies where it takes you on a journey that you can't predict. And I think Lowry balances this fine line of realism and mysticism pretty well. You know, there's always a sense of this world being just beyond the realm that we live in, and which makes it just beyond a comfortable, you know, position, you know, like a comfortable watch. It's something I'll need to rewatch before the end of the year wrap up, and it's I agree with you, it's a yay. What the?
What the hell just happened?
You're coming out of stasis sleep.
Ow!
You may want to sit until the dizziness passes.
What? Why?
Did to keep you guys safe.
From what?
Corona.
The beer?
Speaking of beer, you know what show you should always drink in?
Ugh, that's a stretch. But the In Session Film Podcast.
That's right, Tim. The In Session Film Podcast is JD and Brendan.
What am I isolating with Brendan, if you know what I mean?
What was that, Tim?
Nothing.
Anyways, each week the In Session Film Podcast chooses a movie to review.
And then creates a three list based on what they just saw.
This week, the In Session Film Podcast is reviewing Annette.
And a top three list of the best sex scenes in movies. Hubba, hubba.
Does that include the film I made with Brendan?
What was that, Tim?
Anyways, you can find the show on Apple Podcasts by searching for, you guessed it, the In Session Film Podcast.
Or on the web at insessionfilm.com.
So if you're in the mood for great movie reviews and discussion,
then check out the In Session Film Podcast on Apple Podcasts.
Or on the web at insessionfilm.com.
Okay, so I suppose it's time I filled you in on what y'all missed.
Do go on, please.
Podcasts already seem to address every imaginable subject. A man broke new ground with a seemingly random obsession about exploding helicopters in movies. He was a podcaster on the edge, a maverick broadcaster who played by his own rules. Now, he has a last chance to talk about the strange way helicopters explode in film. Exploding Helicopter, available on iTunes and Podomatic now. Think you know about chopper fireballs? Think again.
This podcast is a proud member of the LAMB Podcasting Network. Find the network at largeassmovieblogs.com.
Okay, let's talk about Pig.
You know, I don't like buyers coming out to the site.
Yeah, hey, Mac. Sorry, I'm just, we're just looking for that couple with the green pickup.
Turquoise.
You got a little something. They haven't been around for a few weeks. What'd they do?
Nothing. Just a little misunderstanding we gotta get sorted out.
They took my pig.
What kind of pig?
It's a truffle pig.
Motherfucker. Wiki, you take over. Anyone fucks with Wiki, I'll break your fingers, motherfuckers!
And just to warn people ahead of time, this will be a spoiler-filled discussion. So beware! The plot. A truffle hunter who lives alone in the Oregonian wilderness must return to his past in Portland in search of his beloved foraging pig after she is kidnapped. The director, Michael Sarnowski. The actors, Nicolas Cage, Alex Wolff, Adam Arkin, and some others. Walter, you like you like Nicolas Cage.
I love Nicolas Cage.
So how was this version of Nicolas Cage?
Just like all the other versions of Nicolas Cage that I've gotten, he's fan-fucking-tastic in everything he does. No matter what movie Nicolas Cage is in, he's always the most interesting thing going on.
I will absolutely, just as an aside, completely agree with that notion, because I got to see Willy's Wonderland over the summer. And the movie is trash, and he doesn't say a goddamn word in the movie, and he is easily the best part of it.
Yep, and this is no different. I love it when Nick Cage gets to flex his acting chops. The last time I remember him being able to do this, where he was actually able to like really tap in there and act, was Bad Lieutenant Protocol New Orleans. I think that's, you know, him playing it, you know, playing it close to the vest. And I think he's doing a lot of that here. A lot of facial acting out of him, a lot of like body language acting in, you know, what he's doing. I'm sure that like there's a very early scene where he is talking to his truffle dealer, where he is doing this like hand motion, which I'm pretty sure he just decided to do as an improvise. I'm pretty sure that wasn't like asked for. It's just Nick Cage going, I think this is going to make things richer. And this movie really subverts expectations. And I think that's one of the reasons why people like it so much, is that they did not get what they expected out of this movie. This movie is, at its core, it is a story about grief and loss and how does one get through it. And over the course of the movie, you know, a lot of people, you know, when something terrible happens, the natural reaction is to, you know, withdraw and all that. And that's what you see it early on. And then as the story progresses, you see that these characters who have all incurred a major loss in their life realize that the only way out of like this pain that they're in because of this loss is to work through it. And they can't necessarily do it by themselves. And I think it's a really, really touching movie in that instance. My favorite scene is toward the end, where Nicolas Cage is cooking for what you expect to be the villain, you know, in all of this. And they have a very interesting conversation about why they are the way they are. And it's because of loss. And this movie is just, it's beautiful. I think it's an amazing study on loss and grief and, you know, processing emotions and attachment and what happens when you lose someone or something close to you.
Hermano, what did you think of Pig?
Well, there was a moment, probably about 30 minutes in, where Mia just happened to walk into the room and she asked me how I was liking the movie so far. And I didn't know what to tell her, because it's a movie that at that moment, I didn't really know if I liked it yet, because it unravels really slowly and deliberately, like half an hour in and I didn't know what I was watching. Like I was like, it seemed pretty straightforward. Like his pig gets taken, he's on the hunt to get the pig back. I didn't know a ton about this movie going in. I just heard rumblings, like probably you guys did, like best Nicolas Cage performance in years. Everyone seemed to really like the movie, you know, critics, audiences. But I didn't know much else other than that. I didn't know if this was going to be a revenge thriller at some point. I'm like, is he going to go like full Mandy in this thing? Like, what's going on? Like, I didn't know. And, you know, it wasn't until a little bit after that I started really putting the pieces together, and you start getting more information, basically. Like, you don't know a lot about Nick Cage at the start. You know that he's a person that hunts truffles with his pig and sells them to this guy, you know, like for restaurant, I'm assuming. And that's all I really knew. And then, you know, Wally already kind of put it together really well. Like, you know, it is a film about, as you learn more about the characters, you know, there are these stories that are told, they recount to one another. And, you know, everything kind of gels together. I will add one more thing that I don't think Wally brought up is I think the film also kind of deals in regret, because there are some scenes that really just seem like they're like just soaked in regret. Like there are things that they wish they could undo, you know, like I felt like there were moments in the film that people made choices, there were actions, and there was no return from them. You know, I guess we're full in spoilers. So I guess from Nicolas Cage's perspective, it felt like maybe he wasn't around all the time for his wife or partner. And it seemed like he was a really in-demand chef, may have not had all the time in the world. And then, you know, obviously he loses his partner and maybe feels some regret about that, isolates himself into the woods. There's the father who's, like Wally said, is kind of set up to be the villain, but also maybe kind of dealing with his own loss and regret at, you know, the actions that, you know, preceded what happens with him. So I think it's really set up well too. In my favorite scene of the film was the scene when he visits that restaurant and yes. He calls for the chef.
Yes.
That was my favorite scene by far, because it sort of encapsulates Nicolas Cage kind of recounting, telling this guy, like, you know, do you love what you're doing? You know, these people don't give a crap about you. Like, do what you love, basically. And it kind of feels like he's pouring himself out onto this guy. Like, don't turn out like me.
Well, you know what he's also doing, which I really love, is he is deconstructing that guy, just like the chef is deconstructing all the meals he serves. It's an amazingly layered scene.
Yes, very well done. And like I said, like really captures exactly what the movie's going for, specifically with Nicolas Cage's character, I felt. But I by the end of the film, I came away really loving it. I think it's probably my favorite thing I've seen all year, though I don't watch as much as you guys probably do. So I do have some other catching up to do, like The Green Knight and things like that. But now, it's by far the favorite thing I've seen.
Considering Nomadland came out, was released this year, would you rank it above or just below Nomadland?
You know, I forgot about Nomadland. I may have to reevaluate.
Okay, fair enough.
I have to think about it.
I'm on the same page as you guys. This movie is great. A couple of days ago when I watched it, it was my second time watching it. I had actually watched it a month ago for the first time. And I loved it just as much then, too. So it's been really rewarding on a rewatch. This movie reminded me like of a mix between somebody we already mentioned, David Lowery and Kelly Reichardt. It has both of those, I don't know, kind of elements there. I can definitely see some influence. There's this somber, gentle pace with the script that kind of slowly informs you, that you kind of alluded to, Hermano, that it never holds your hand, and I never knew what direction it was going to go. And Cage is brilliant in this. He really does give a remarkable performance. It's nuanced. He's someone who's barely holding back his grief, yet whose skills remain untarnished. And I love that reputation, how it holds weight wherever you go, despite his character being gone from the public eye for over 10 years. That last shot, by the way, the last shot of this film is gorgeous. You talk about perfectly framed shots. The way he's sitting on that bed as he looks down at the empty, blanket or whatever his pig had been sleeping on. And then he looks up at the light. He's mourning two individuals in his life at that point, and just the way he looks up and the light frames his face, that's gorgeous. It's a chef's kiss, if you will. Guys, we haven't even talked about the Underground Restaurant Workers Fight Club yet.
I bring it up because I had no idea what was going on. I was like, what is this scene doing in this film?
Wally, what do you think?
weird. Does it advance the story? No, not really. I don't think this movie necessarily needed it. But it didn't really detract from the story either, so I can't complain about it too much. It was kind of just like this weird – I don't know if this actually was in the script, but this is like Nick Cage pitching an idea of like, how about an underground restaurant fight club?
I don't know. It's interesting you say that because the director has such a control over the pace and tone of this movie that I for some reason that scene fits within everything else that it doesn't seem like a Nicolas Cage insertion. I could be wrong, but I don't know. It works. What do you make out of that, Hermano?
Again, this is at a point where I still didn't know what was happening in this film. And I'm like, all right, is this where it's going to go full Mandy? this is where the real hardcore stuff is going to hit. And it felt off. Like you guys are describing it as a fight club, but it's pretty one-sided. Like right. It seemed like the idea of it was for one person to just take a beating. Like, I didn't understand that. Like guys seem to be like vying to be the highest bidder in order to like just beat on someone for like a set amount of time or something.
Right, I guess.
Like I did not understand the well, logic behind this.
Maybe it reflects the competitive nature of the restaurant business in this area or just in general and how cutthroat it is, and I will do anything to beat you down, and or maybe it's a way of releasing, you know, however you want to look at it within this universe, you know, this world of restaurateurs and how they want to get back at their competitors or something like that. I don't know. It's interesting.
It's certainly interesting. It just felt – it's definitely the standout, like, what is this scene doing in this film moment of the movie. Like, it just felt off compared to everything else. Like, it felt like it was going, like, down this dark path, but then it ultimately kind of comes out of it.
Mm. Yeah. I love how every character here – seeks out or has some kind of command of a form of status within their lives, except for Nicolas Cage's Rob, who just doesn't give a shit. And I think that's one of the reasons of his success and reputation. You know, like Alex Wolff's character, he is striving to come out of the shadow of his father and succeed in his own business, and seek this type of status. You notice, you remember he's there's a scene where he's talking to himself in the mirror and how he wants respect, his father already has the respect that he is seeking. Every character here has some sort of, I don't know, reputation, if you will, or they're seeking to gain that. I talked about the deliberate pace. It only takes 12 minutes for the film to kick into gear with its plot. It's really interesting how, I don't know, I don't know. I just felt like a sense of control. Like there was a real steady hand at the direction of this movie. And you have everything you need to know before those 12 minutes about Rob as a person, and his character is really wonderfully laid out in those ensuing 80 minutes. Those afterwards, it's great. Wally, was there anything else you wanted to mention, maybe about Nicolas Cage's performance or anything else?
There's this one like kind of wacky ish bit where like they go into like the woods and there's like the like truffle processing woman.
Sure.
And they're like, have you seen this? He's trying to like dance, he's trying to dance around like the subject, but like Nicolas is like, they stole my pig. And she's like, damn it. And she just, the next scene is just like this convoy of cars going to the tweaker's house. I thought that was kind of a interesting little twist that lady just like flipped on a dime like that. The rest of the movie, I think it's a pretty straightforward movie. I mean, it does play itself out slowly but surely. But this movie is really direct, you know, especially when he's, I think the other scene that's also really good too is when he's sitting there talking to Ellen, the baker.
Yeah.
That he knows from, you know, from previous, and she has set up shop in his old restaurant. And, you know, he's asking her about like the, you know, the salted baguette, because he's going to make this exact meal, which you find out afterwards is basically he's doing it from memory. The last meal that the antagonist of the movie had with his wife before he lost her.
Right.
And then his like revelation that he's like, I remember every meal, like every person who came into my restaurant, what they ordered. And at this point, like, I'm like, Nick Cage is a super chef. Like, and as a person who finds relaxation in cooking, and like a lot of people talk about how, like, there's like, you know, when you do this, this is your love language. Like, that's mine, is baking things for other people. Like, I enjoy, I don't get stressed when it comes to cooking, no matter how complex the recipe is. I enjoy doing that so that I can present the people that I care about something great. You know what I mean? As great as my skills can let me make it. You know what I mean? And if I don't think it's great, I will try it again later to make it better than the last time. And this movie, I think, really touched that for me.
Mm-hmm.
And so really struck a chord with, you know, at the end when he's teaching the son how to make this exact dish. Like, he's not cooking, he's teaching at the same time. Like, you, without any, and there's no dialogue in the scene either. You know, he's showing them how to hold, like, the hen carcass so that you can cut it this way. And this is how you layer the potatoes in the pan. Absolutely brilliant. And it's really, really, you know, it really, really does highlight, you know, when someone makes something for you, that that's a big deal. Like, you know, in, you know, relationships, like, that's like a thing that people get worried about when they're getting ready to, you know, move their relationship forward is, you know, eventually. There's always been this, like, I can't say it's always been this way, but, like, I'm sure it's not everybody has felt this way, but there's that anxiety that some people get when their person that they've been dating for X amount of time is coming over for dinner and they're going to make something for them. Like, will they like it? Will they like me after I've done, after I'm done making this? And this, I think, really brings that, like, I think it highlights that, you know what I mean? Like, yeah. What goes into cooking for somebody.
Sure. Romano, is there anything else that stuck out to you that you feels worth mentioning?
Yeah, I just liked how all the scenes featuring Nick Cage and the dad, I felt like they were sort of helping each other at the same time. Like, Nick Cage is working, obviously still working through his own issues, and at the same time he's helping the dad sort of try to come to terms with his own circumstances. The scene where he asks the father if he's always been this way, and, you know, his response. And I just feel like Nick Cage and him obviously have a lot in common.
Mm.
They both lost people that they love dearly. They both were changed quite a bit. You know, they turned into different versions of themselves, you know, based on their circumstances. And I thought that was a good thing the film explored really well, too, is like, you know, people just having all these different versions of yourself through life. And, like, you know, Nick Cage was probably this in-demand, like I said, like, in-demand chef, you know, probably was super busy all the time, maybe didn't have as much time for, you know, domestic stuff as he would have liked, and really regrets that, you know, he wasted all this time on, you know, customers and this image and, you know, this idea of, you know, what he was supposed to be. And again, another reason why I like that restaurant scene where he's, you know, talking to his former, person that used to work for him and, you know, saying like, you know, none of this is real. Like, you're not real. Like, this is all like stuff you put out, but this is not really truly what you wanted to do or what you wanted to be. But somewhere along the line, you took this other path. And again, I it goes into that like whole regret aspect of, you know, sometimes you can't take things back. And, you know, I think they're both living with, you know, that guilt and that regret.
Anything else to mention before we get into grades? Are we good?
So apparently I was looking on IMDb trivia. There is a 60 minute extended cut of this movie.
And another
60 minutes?
There's another 60 minutes missing from this movie. Yeah. They cut it out because distributors thought it was too long.
I was so glad it was an hour and a half. I thought it's so well. It does so well with the amount of time it has. I don't know that I'd want to see more.
Yeah, I agree. It's almost perfect as it is. All right, Wally, what grade would you give this?
A solid A, baby.
Same here. Solid A for me, Hermano.
Make it a triple A.
Whoa.
Hell yeah.
Okay, that does it for this episode of the First Time Watchers podcast. Donate via patreon.com/firsttimewatchers or buy stuff at zazzle.com/firsttimewatchers.
You can talk to us on Twitter at 1STTimeWatchers on Twitter.
Or write to us at our email, firsttimewatchers@gmail.com.
Please leave a review for us on Apple Podcasts or Stitcher. We'd love feedback. If you have any suggestions of movies for us to watch, please send a tweet or an email. Speaking of suggestions, let's recommend a movie, Wally.
All right, so we got Nicolas Cage here, so let's go with a Nicolas Cage movie. And we're going to go with good old Face Off. Nicolas Cage is an insane old bad guy in a John Woo film against John Travolta. And it's just a fantastic actioner, sci-fi action, so good. Well, if you haven't seen it, get off your ass. There's not really much more I can say about this. Face Off.
I'm going to recommend a movie I saw a few days ago, and it is called Money Plane. It was released in 2020. It was directed by Andrew Lawrence, who is one of the Lawrence brothers, the most famous Lawrence brother being Joey Woe Lawrence, you know. This movie stars Adam Copeland, also known
as the Rated R Superstar.
Yeah, Edge on WWE, I guess. Kelsey Grammer and Thomas Jane and a bunch of unknowns. A professional thief with $40 million in debt and his family's life on the line must commit one final heist to rob a futuristic airborne casino filled with the world's most dangerous criminals. This has a whopping 3.2 rating on IMDb. And I will tell you, it is about 7 points too low, because Kelsey Grammer deserved a Best Supporting Actor Oscar nomination. I'm not even joking. If you took a shot every time they say Money Plane, you would be dead in 20 minutes. I'm pretty sure they shot this on a porn set. The Russian roulette scene belongs in the Hall of Fame. A dude has his ears ripped off and dies because of it. Thomas Jane helps defend a Lawrence from an armed squad with a drone that has a gun attached to it. And Kelsey Grammer demands a person he is torturing not piss himself. 5 stars. Unbelievably entertaining movie. Guys, it's worth your 80 minutes. Hermano?
All right, like I said earlier, when I, you know, I'd heard the little rumblings of Pig, I'd heard it, you know, being described as Nicolas Cage's best performance in years. And I'm like, we can all agree that his last best performance was Mandy, right?
Sure.
Because everyone who's seen Mandy has got to agree that that's the last great performance from Nicolas Cage. Came out in 2018, my favorite movie of the year that year, directed by Panos Cosmatos. I loved it, man. I'll read the synopsis here, and it's all you need. All I need to say. The enchanted lives of a couple in a secluded forest are brutally shattered by a nightmarish hippie cult and their demon biker henchmen, propelling a man into a spiraling, surreal rampage of vengeance. So good. Pretty hardcore, though, so not for the squeamish. Maybe not a good double bill with Pig.
Okay, stay tuned for our next episode. Second Time Watchers is back. We'll be talking about a film from my childhood, speaking of legendary actors, the Steven Seagal vehicle. Under Siege 2, Dark Territory.
I can't wait for this. This is the First Time Watchers podcast because we like to watch. Tell me now, baby, is it good to you? Can he do the things that I do? Oh, no. I can take you high. It's like someone took a knife, baby, edgy and dull, and cut a 6-inch valley through the middle of my skull.
How was your summer, or most of your summer?
Most of my summer has been okay, has been all right. I went to New York City.
How was that?
It was a lot of fun. A lot of fun. Stayed in Times Square. Did all the typical touristy shit. As you would do in New York City, and it's a good time. A lot of fun. A lot of fun. A lot of walking. We did about 20 miles of walking total that weekend.
Wow.
Yeah. Yeah. And had to take showers like 3 times a day because it was so hot, you know, all that walking and then going to the subway and then it was a lot of fun. It was you know, stuff I had seen before, but you know, my first time at One World Trade Center, you know, the new tower but you know, I went to Ellis Island and Statue of Liberty, and I went to the Museum of the Moving Image, where they had a display, a showing of, I don't know, stuff from 2001, A Space Odyssey, from Jim Henson, and the creation of the Muppets, and the rise of the show and the production company, and yeah, it was cool. It was cool.
Nice.
What about yourself? How was your summer?
It was good. Mostly did what we considered relatively safe family trips.
Sure.
We went to Connecticut, and we went to the, I don't know if you ever heard it. It's called the Dinosaur Place. It's like a big, like, I don't know how many acres, like, park, and they have like a bunch of like hiking trails basically, but across all the hiking trails, there's like, it's basically like set up like a Jurassic Park sort of. And, you know, most for kids, of course, but they have like animatronics and like a volcano that erupts every hour or something.
Nice.
They also have a water park there. Well, it's not really a water park. It's more like a really big splash pad. we did that. We went to Mystic Aquarium. And then just a couple weeks ago, we went to the Cape Cod Inflatable Water Park. Have you ever heard of that?
Cape Cod Inflatable Water Park?
Yeah.
No.
It's basically like, think of like, you know, you rent like a bouncy house for like a kid's birthday or something like that. Think about that, but like maybe like 10 stories tall. Huh. It's like massive. Like, wow. They have massive like inflatables that are like water slides, Ninja Warrior courses.
Nice.
Just a bunch of different like obstacles. They've actually, this is like the second time we went there. They updated it to where they have a lot more like legit, like Ninja Warrior stuff. Like, it's not just for kids. Like, cool. I could have gotten on some of this stuff. They have like trapezes that you have to like traverse, like you would on Ninja Warrior. Like, you have to like swing and then swing to another bar that's swinging and then swing to another one. It's like, it looks pretty intense. I didn't end up doing it cause I was with the kids the whole time, but kind of wanted to.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And then they have like a legit water park there, like kind of like something you would see at Great Wolf Lodge or something.
Nice.
Mostly for kids, but yeah, we did like kind of like family trips like that were mostly outdoors, and we felt like pretty safe, you know, overall.
Cool.